control the plane. Put everything, everything's coming right back. Don't get lost anymore, you can really stay right here. No, you can really stay right here. Control the plane, put everything, everything's coming right back. Don't get lost anymore, you can really stay right here.
Welcome everyone to this CNCF webinar. My name is Diego Braga and I'm working as a solution architect in Kiratech. And here with me, I have my three colleagues, Mauro, Yanis and Luca. And today we are happy to show you our new open source product that is called Krateo Platform Ops. And we are gonna delight you with some live demos, and we hope that you are gonna be excited about what we are doing with this product. So let me share my slides, and I invite my colleague later on. So Krateo Platform Ops is an open source platform which was born 1 year ago. Which aim is to describe and create and maintain services and resources. So basically what we are seeing every day in our job is that it's getting more complicated dominating the ecosystem that is increasing in complexity. It's a richer and richer perimeter of solutions, and our customers, our colleagues are struggling to find a way to dominate, to governate this ecosystem. And so the platform teams are struggling to find a way to create all the services that their users need. These services can be anything, can be infrastructure, Kubernetes clusters, networking rules, can be infrastructure for machine learning models, can be reports for data scientists. So platform teams are looking for a way to standardize the way they offer services and resources. And we found out that using Kubernetes APIs is the way to go for the standardization. And so Krateo leverages Kubernetes APIs and their extensions, which we believe and all the market believes that they are de facto standard for products that are running in cloud native infrastructure. So Krateo is based on Kubernetes and is leveraging the Kubernetes APIs. Basically, what we are doing in Kiratech, we are a silver member of the CNCF. We do cloud native service provider, and we are also helping our customers with some vertical practices that they enable us to follow the best practice on keeping up and running in the best way their infrastructure and securing vertically the life cycle of their infrastructure and their applications. Where Krateo is taking all its architecture, basically from the CNCF landscape, that is our goal to achieve in order to find out what are the best of breed technologies, the most up to date. There are some guidelines that help you to find what is the best tool to use based on the maturity of the product, based on the community, and since we work every day on this landscape, we do know what are the best tools to propose to the customer in our architecture. And we put all our technology expertise in this open source product. So anyone can take Krateo and scale to the right dimension the cloud native approach within their realities. So, we can use Krateo because a lot of customers, a lot of friends are asking us, should I use Krateo in a greenfield company? What if I am an enterprise company? It is not like this. You can use it in any stage of maturity of your company, maturity on the cloud native approach. So basically, if you are a greenfield company, you are starting from day one, you can leverage Krateo as a foundation to embrace the cloud native transition, leveraging the architecture that is opinionated and based on a central framework that helps you to connect to new services and centralize all the information you need. But also, if you are an enterprise company, Krateo is a framework that helps you to standardize the heterogeneity of your services, your automations, and usually we see that there is not a single glass of pane for any services that maybe your silos that are transitioning to a more cloud native approach still have in place. So if you need to find a standard to agree on how you expose your services that have been deployed and automated from different areas of the company, Krateo can help you to standardize the cloud native adoption in your enterprise level. So basically, what are the use cases which can help you to can be solved with Krateo? I do love the Team Topologies book, so I put a lot of reference to it. And the platform ops is the approach that Krateo wants to help. The FinOps is the second use case. FinOps is no more a buzzword, it is something that we need to focus a lot. And 2022 it's really the year for FinOps because distributed systems, microservices, cloud native architectures increase the number of components that you need to be aware of. And be aware of, especially from a cost allocation and cost optimization point of view. The last but not the least is upskilling. So the automation, standardization, Kubernetes APIs are not a complicated skill to achieve. And if you agree on a standard, on a way to expose your services and consume them, then you can move from manual tasks that are not interesting in your daily work, but you can move to more designer perspective for the automation. You become an engineer of the solution and the the automation provisioning of whatever services you're offering to your users. So to focus on the first use case, how a platform team can provide services to their streamlined team. So just a very brief introduction of platform team, streamlined team. As I said, this terminology is taken from Team Topologies, which is a book that I really, really love. Platform team is basically a group of people that work to expose services in a self-service manner to their users. They can be internal users, external users, but basically, you never talk with a platform team, opening a ticket and stuff like that, sending an email, taking the phone and calling the platform team. But the platform team and the role of the platform team is to expose services with the SLAs that needs to be ensured. And so how a platform team can provide these services to their users that typically are the streamlined team. Streamlined team are a group of people that aim to release new functionalities, new products in a more safe, independent, quick way as possible. So they never need the friction with the other team. They need to go faster. They need to consume services whenever they want. And so this is the question: how a platform team can help a streamlined team to consume these services. So the first point is automation. You need to put automation in distributed systems. You cannot have any more silos. You need to jump on different platforms, and you need to provision whatever you need to offer. So automation is what you need to do. Automation is required. And once you have put in place your automation, you need to expose your services to your users using a self-service catalog. And these services, as I said before, can be really anything, can be infrastructure. Maybe you have a template of software that you want your developer to use when you are onboarding them. Maybe you have models of machine learning that you want to share in your data scientist community, etc. So as you can imagine, platform teams are struggling to offer all these services at the velocity that streamlined team need. And to get things even more complicated, services can be really anywhere. They were on premise, maybe they were born greenfield on a public cloud, but maybe your company is transitioning to an hybrid cloud model or even a multi-cloud model where you wanna have a higher, even higher service level availability, and then maybe you spread your application, your platforms on multi-cloud. So you can imagine platform teams are looking for a way to build what is a platform ops. So basically a platform to expose these services. And there are some point of attention. Basically, automation for each service is specialized. So if you need to provision the same component in different cloud providers, you have different automations to keep and maintain. The day two operation is still to automate. So how can I avoid configuration drift? If I provision with very well written automation, my infrastructure, my services, my resources, and someone changes the characteristics, the settings, the dimension, number of CPUs, and stuff like that manually, I can be aware of that. So day two operation is still something that needs to be addressed. And what about legacy environments? Legacy environments means something that is maybe on place in a data center on premise. So the cloud native transition, the cloud native methodology is really great. We do know that everyone is going there, but companies, maybe they have still a 90% of their workload on premise in legacy environments that are not on Kubernetes. So how can I handle this other part of my data center? Anchor.teo platform ops want to address these open points for the platform team. Then there is the other part, so the stream aligned team that wants to consume these services, as I said, in a quickly, safely, and independently as possible way. So the only way to help them to achieve this scope is exposing this catalog of self-service internal services. That this catalog must be user-friendly and reliable. I mean, if I am a developer, if I am data scientist, whatever kind of user I am, I need to know the minimal set of information to consume this service. Okay. And I don't need to put detailed information that belong as a knowledge to the platform team. And another interesting point is that once I create a resource that can be, as I said, a microservice, can be a Kubernetes cluster, etc., I need to have all the data of the lifecycle of the service centralized because, as you see, there is a colleague with a headache on the right part of the slide. The onboarding experience right now is a nightmare because we have really a lot of tools, and usually a developer, as an example for a user, has like a dozen tabs open in its browser. One tab for logging, another one for the continuous integration, continuous deployment pipelines. This user wants to see monitoring metrics, code coverage reports, maybe they need to access infrastructure. So it's becoming complex to keep all the data you need in place, in a central place, in a clear way. And the other interesting open point is the ownership of services. So we do love microservices, but because you can reuse them, basically. I don't need to rewrite a microservice if it's already written from another team, but I need to know who developed that microservice. So if I want to see my team, how many resources owns, how can I share my resources with other teams, where can I access to the documentation, where is the Open API documentation, where is the repository and stuff like that. It's a task that is becoming more and more complicated if you don't govern it from the beginning. The second use case is FinOps. As I said, FinOps is no more a buzzword. Cloud cost management is a practice that allows you to have visibility on how you spend money on cloud, how your distributed teams are investing their budget. So as it's written here, it's more a cultural practice than just a cost allocation, because everyone needs to take ownership of their cloud usage, but you need to give them tools to help them and have insights on how they are spending their money. And so cost allocation and cost optimization insight are really, really, really important, and you need the right level of standard and abstraction to govern it, the heterogeneity of your perimeter that can be really anything. The third use case, I said, is upskilling. So you need to you have to transition to upskill your knowledge to a more engineering approach. So leaving manual tasks and repetitive tasks to automation and transitioning, focusing on the design of the architecture and the automation. And Carpeo implements we call it a flight simulator to help you with the demos and example on the adoption of this standard. So just to wrap up, Crateo is a platform that you can install on your Kubernetes. It needs to be a certified distribution, but it's universal because with the Crateo, you can handle really anything you want everywhere. It's deeply coupled with the self-service approach, so anything you want can be any service you developed and you want to offer to your users can be exposed in the self-service catalog. And it's flexible because there are no limits, technical limits to Crateo to say, okay, I can handle just the kind of resources, but the limit is just the imagination or the business needs. This is the reference architecture. So we do have our opinionated architecture, but that doesn't mean that if you want anything else, you cannot use it. So it's since Crateo is on Kubernetes, it's using the same approach. So it's all the components are loosely coupled. You can swap with what you want, and then you can use it. If you have already in place something, you don't need to put a module from Crateo, but you can use your own that is already in place. So this is the reference architecture. This means that Crateo wants to help you to centralize the life cycle of anything you want from the builder release phase to the runtime phase. There are some pillars that are vertical, that are observability and DevSecOps, because they need to really be ensured from all the phases of your life cycle, but you can for sure use whatever you want. This is just a reference architecture where we do believe these are some tools that are the best right now, but anyway, it's something that we are continuously refreshing because you can understand how the ecosystem is moving as fast as we can imagine. This is the architecture, the core architecture of Crateo. Crateo is built on Kubernetes. And Crateo deeply relies on really two great open source projects that are backstage for the developer portal. Three open source projects right now. So the backstage is a developer portal, Argo CD for the CD part, and Crossplane for the interaction between Kubernetes and the outside world. So our front-end is based on Backstage. Crateo is an early adopter of Backstage, so we are working together on it. Anything that is created via the Crateo dashboard is a manifest. It's a YAML manifest that is versioned in a Git repo. And then Argo CD is automatically configured to pull changes from these repos and apply them in the Kubernetes cluster, where the Crateo runtime that is built on Crossplane handles is custom resources that are a logical representation of outside resources. And my colleague Luca will live demo, so finger crossed for you, Luca, will live demo the provider that we wrote for interacting with VMware, because we did some demos to some colleagues, and they were saying us, okay, it's great that Crossplane provides you providers for Google, Amazon, Azure, etc., and the community is increasing, the project is great, we love it, more and more people are contributing with other providers, we are going to contribute ourselves with our providers to the community. And but our colleagues said, okay, but if I need to spin up a virtual machine on premise, then how we can do it? It's the point of the legacy environments. So Luca will show you how we did it. And as I said, we are leveraging on Backstage, that is an open platform released from Spotify engineering team to the CNCF. And right now is a sandbox project growing. And Crossplane is, I think every one of you knows about Crossplane, but still it's been written by the guys from Upbound and released to the CNCF community. And it's leveraging custom resource definition on Kubernetes with an opinionated way to write your own providers and interact with the outside world from Kubernetes, and Crossplane is an incubating project of the CNCF. So, I'm gonna leave the stage to Luca, that will demo you the interaction with the VMware infrastructure. If you want to bootstrap your on-premise Krateo or whatever you have a Kubernetes cluster that is a certified distribution, you can follow this link. And we have the landing page where you can see in English and in Italian where all the information that I explained you in these slides. So if you want to keep in touch with us, you can write in these channels, and I will be more than happy to give you all the information. We are hiring, so please apply to these channels, and I'll invite Luca on the stage.
Hi, thanks,
Good morning,
Diego.
Luca.
Hi.
Good evening. It
Good
depends on
evening.
where, what time you're looking at this video. And I'll let you share your slides, okay? And have fun.
Okay, thanks, Diego. Hi to everyone. And in the next few minutes, I will show you what is a Krateo runtime provider and how it works. And we will do a live demo, crossing fingers, on Krateo vSphere provider. So let's start from the slide that Diego showed us. Oh, sorry. Okay. Here is the architecture of the Krateo platform. I'm working here on the Krateo runtime. So let's concentrate on Krateo runtime, and we'll see how a runtime provider works. It is a smart client for any external web service. Smart because it's able to communicate, to continuously monitor the asset exposed by services and make sure that they meet our criteria. The only condition is that those services expose some sort of a crude API. Can be REST, SOAP, any protocol, it's fine. It continuously monitor a specific resource exposed by the particular remote service, compares the status of this resource with the one we want, that is our desired states defined in this YAML resource. Here we have a picture that show how it works. Then eventually apply the necessary changes to make the specific resource conform to our specs by invoking the remote service CRUD API. We define our desired states in this YAML manifest, so in a declarative way. Let's see how to apply those concepts to our vSphere provider. So the first thing, and this is one-shot operation, we have to configure the provider. To configure the provider, we need to provide the server address of our vCenter, a classic credential, username, and eventually a password. The password that is specified in a secret. As you can see here, we have a secret reference to the secret that contains the password. Then we can specify other parameters, such as insecure, when we have, in this case, we disable the strict TLS validation because we have a handcrafted certificate. And eventually, you can put your provider in the debug. So you will have a lot of logs. You can log all the remote SOAP calls. It's useful for troubleshooting. Once you have defined your provider config, you can submit this to Kubernetes clusters, and we have set up our provider. Then, we need to define the desired state for our virtual machine. We want to create a virtual machine, so we have to specify the parameters for the virtual machine. There are a lot. Here we have only just a few of them. So we can specify the data center where to put this virtual machine, the resource pool, the data store, the guest ID of the operating system type, the name of the virtual machine, and then the total number of virtual processor, the memory sites. In this case, we have 2 gigabytes of memory. Eventually, we can specify if we want to start our VM with powered on or off. We can specify the network to attach this virtual machine, the disk, the sites. Eventually, we can specify also the controller. There are a lot of parameters. You can check eventually the documentation for all the parameters. And then we need to put a reference to the previous configuration. As you can see here, we have the provider config reference with the name vSphere provider config that we have defined before. Here we have the name vSphere provider config. Now we will start with a demo. We will create a virtual machine simply by defining our desired spec in a YAML file. We will edit the virtual machine parameters like CPU, memory, using the vCenter dashboard. And then we will destroy the virtual machine using the vCenter dashboard. And we will see how the provider will restore the virtual machine configuration according to what we have defined in our manifest. Let's hope that all works. Okay, so here we have our manifest. It's the same that we have seen in the slides, but with the real parameters. The name of the virtual machine will be Krateo 00, 4 number of virtual processors, 2 gigabytes of memory. The virtual machine will be powered off. Then we attach to this network and we will create a disk of 10 gigabytes. Okay. So let's apply this manifest. Okay, we have the vCenter with nothing. As you can see, there is nothing on our here. The virtual machine is created with the 4 CPU, 2 gigabytes of memory, and a hard disk of 10 gigabytes. Now let's edit using the dashboard. Let's change some values. Let's see, I want a 12 CPU and a memory of 16 gigabytes. Okay, let's apply. Here it's changed, as you can see in the dashboard. Now, if we came back to our provider, let's see. Okay, this is the debug. Okay, it's running. In the next passage, he will monitor the current state of the virtual machine. He will check the difference and apply the change according to our desired states, because this is the only source of truth. Here you can see the log with the differences. Okay, it's running. As you can see, he has detected the difference. The number CPU was 4, now is 12. The memory gigabyte desired is 2, now is 16. And if we go on the vCenter, as you can see here, we have again 4 CPU and 2 gigabytes of memory. At the same time, if we delete the virtual machine using the dashboard, okay, it's deleted. Now, in the next passage, there is a time of 2 minutes, if I remember correctly, so we have to wait just a little bit. And we will see that the virtual machine will be recreated according to our specs that we have. Okay, it's here, it's passing. Okay. Okay, as you can see, it didn't found the virtual machine and recreated again. So according to our desired state, 4 CPU, 2 gigabyte, and the hard disk of 10 gigabyte. So it perfectly worked. The only source of truth is our manifest that is here. So Diego, that's all.
This live demo went well, so great job, fine. Luca.
Thanks.
So I have just a question for you because I think it could be something that someone looking at this webinar could ask. So is it based on Terraform or Ansible, the provider? Could you?
No. It's we wrote from the scratch everything. So no, it's a client to the vSphere SOAP API.
Okay.
No Terraform.
Okay. So basically, what we saw is that if for any reason you are modifying the settings of the virtual machine, then Krateo via its runtime that is based on Crossplane is aware of the drift and the changes, reverse the changes to the source of truth that is the manifest.
Yeah, as I told before, there are a lot of parameters. We can eventually specify an ISO, so our virtual machine can do something and not only stay put. And so we can specify different operative system. There are a lot of parameters that we can our customer can check on the documentation.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much, Luca.
Thank you to you.
And I think it's time to invite Yanis. Welcome, Yanis. And Yanis is going to show us another interesting aspect of Krateo. As I said in the previous slides, but I'm gonna recap it. Whatever you create from Krateo is deeply built with monitoring by design, secure by design, etc. And if you do know what are logs, metrics, and topology for your services, when you create your resources, then from a monitoring perspective, you are helping your users to centralize all the information and the relevant data you need. So Yanis worked on building a Grafana dashboard which integrates logs and traces from the architecture we chose in Krateo. So Yanis, the stage is yours. Have fun and see you later.
Thank you. So what is the challenge? Cloud native approach and DevOps approach solved many, many single unit complexities. Most of the issues now in a single unit have been solved, but you have got one big problem. There is a lot of tools, and there is tool sprawl, what already was mentioned. So what we made here is single pane of glass for SRE, for development teams, for observability, how to integrate together like different components from cloud native foundation, ecosystem and non-cloud native foundation tools, but they are default standards for DevOps and observability. In this case, we took cloud native foundation project Kuma, a service mesh, which is developed by Kong. We put together with Kong Ingress. We used Grafana Tempo, Grafana, and Loki stack. And I will show how it works, how easy it is to debug microservices when something goes wrong. So demo. So I'm showing demo. So for starters, we have deployed Kubernetes cluster with Kuma service mesh. It took only like few few minutes to set up and get it running. We have some services already, some microservices being served here. We have set up the centralized tracing from service mesh. And now I will show the application. Here is some simple microservice application based on three services. We can check out what's going on here. We can see some info about books. And now the show. So here we go. Here we get logs from the corresponding application. We can click on log and we can see there is some activity happening. The cool thing what we have here, we have got integration with Tempo. Tempo is a new approach to storing traces from Grafana Labs. We click here and we see the how it goes, the whole process, how we gone through the from ingress to product page to book info, detailed info, and so on. You can click, you can see the latencies, you can see how long takes whole process. And very cool thing, we have got all as well node graph. We can see in visual way how it worked and where was the latencies, where was the issues, and so on. Very nice feature about the service mesh what we are using for this demo Kuma is that it will work not just in your Kubernetes cluster, but it will work also as well as on virtual machines. And you can deploy, for example, also in your data layer or your caching layer or resources outside the Kubernetes cluster. So you will have full visibility of the infrastructure, and it can solve, like, you as you see here is single pane of glass for the platform team, for SRE teams, for development teams. You don't need to go through the many other places. You can just click. You can see here how the processes are still happening here. And you can also browse through your Tempo part. You can browse your logs, show logs, and you can see the traces in this way as well, not just from this. So it works in both directions. That's basically all from my side. Diego, do you have
Thank questions? You so much, Yanis. No, I think that second live demo went great, and thank you so much. I really think that having all the informations within the same dashboard really helps you to immediately focus on the issue, whatever it is. And this is something that is the scope of Krateo Platform Ops, to put everything you need in the same place, if you are using Kuma, Tempo, whatever tools you're using, but the scope is to simplify whatever you need in a single point.
Last note from my side, even this is in normal way it could be very complex, but it works so easily and so flawlessly that you will forget how easy it is. And like you will forget how complex it is because it works so nicely and so ridiculously simple. Yeah.
Okay, Yanis, thank you so much for being with us. Did you have fun? Yes, you have fun. Okay.
Yeah.
See you later.
Yeah, bye-bye.
And I invite on the stage my colleague Mauro. Hi, Mauro.
Hi.
You have the responsibility to take the last part of the webinar. Okay, so no pressure. And the last thing we would like to showcase you is the dashboard that is based on Backstage. So how you can expose services from your platform team to your Streamline teams, how you centralize all the relevant data in the same dashboard, how you see pipelines status, how you see OpenAPI documentation, whatever metrics and stuff like that, without accessing your infrastructure, how your pods are working, if they are healthy or not. But I don't want to steal your job, so Mauro, please take the microphone and have fun.
Okay, thank you, Diego. Okay, I show you how to create an app, a front-end app with React, a back-end app with Node.js, and a database with MySQL. The first thing we need to do for create this app is to, is to import a template in Krateo, and Krateo, after some minutes, create the application. But what is a template? A template is a YAML file with we can put all the fields required to develop our application. And just for example, I have make this. This is a YAML file, and this is the template I'll use to create our application. Okay, come back. So this is a template, and now we create the app. I take the URL of my template, and I go to my Krateo Platform Ops dashboard. In the create page, I go to register existing component, and I put the URL of the template. When I click on analyze button, Krateo analyze the template and check it if all the template is write correctly. In if all is okay, you can import the template. Okay, it's done. I'm in the available templates. I choose the Renomy app template. So the first step is the name of our application. Just for example, Krateo-demo/hot. The description. I use these infos for search my app in Krateo Platform Ops. The third field is the admin username. This is the admin. We have the default value because the who writes the template has specified that must be the admin username, but I can change. And this is the ownership of this service. These are groups that are groups from Kiratech Active Directory, and I'll make a choice and use Kerberos owner. The second step is to choose URL. This is the app URL and the API URL. So is the DNS name where you can expose our application. Just for example, I put app1.krateo.io and api1.krateo.io. So next step, and the third step is where to put the Git repository. I have the host GitHub, the owner is me, Mauro Sala, and repository is, in this case, the same name of my application. So next step, I have a summary, and I can review all the fields that I filled. And if all is okay, I can create my template. I show you that my repositories are 10 in this moment. Okay. Let's create my application. it's fetching the template, publishing, registering, creating the application Argo CD, Sonar Cloud, and GitHub branch protection. So all the steps are okay, but what is doing? So load the template, Cloudtail fetch the last version of the template, publish repo on GitHub, il saves all the files, needed files to the GitHub repository, register the app in Cloudtail Platform Ops, create the app on Argo CD, create the app on Sonar Cloud, and set GitHub branch protection rules. After this, Argo CD and GitHub works in parallel. So Argo deploy Kubernetes settings and start creation on the DB on AWS, and GitHub build Docker images. When the images are ready, Kubernetes can deploy a pod, and when the database on AWS, AWS is ready, application is ready and published. I'll back on my dashboard. I'll show you that in my databases, I have the Cloudtail demo hot is creating. And so we go to the home. And this is the application that I just created, but I show you the Fat Squirrels backend and frontend because it is fully completed. So the overview tab is the first tab when I go in the Fat Squirrels backend. We have the about card. We can view the source. We with a click we can go to the repository on GitHub, tech docs and the API I show you later. The description, the owner is the Active Directory group. The system I show you later. The type is a service. Lifecycle is experimental, but I can specify production, developing, testing, or it's up to you. And the tags, in this case, I have no tags. The second card we have in the overview tab is the links. I can put helpful links, for example, an Excel file on your SharePoint or something else. In this case, these links go to the repository again. This component, the backend, does not have subcomponents. And this is the first integration with external services. The code quality is from Sonar Cloud. I have the scorecard, the summary, but if I want to show more, I can click, I can go to the Sonar Cloud website and view more. Dashboard and alerts are the cards about Grafana. I have created a dashboard for Grafana for Fat Squirrels. Okay, just a second, login. And my dashboard has a number of pods, the CPU, the memory, and the latest logs. Alerts in this case is empty. This is the Argo CD card, and I go to the Argo CD. I show you that Cloudtail Demo Hot is the application that I created before, is running, is still creating. And I can view all the components that are in my application. But I have a summary, an overview here. The second tab is the CI/CD. I go with the login, okay. And this is the list of the pipeline of my repository. Okay, this is an error, but just for a demo. I can click on the title. I have a summary, and I can go to jobs, and I can go to logs. It's here. It's not necessary to go to GitHub. It's all in Cloudtail. API, So this backend exposes the Fat Squirrels API, but not consumed. In the front end, the Fat Squirrels front end is exactly the different because not provides API, but consumes. Dependencies backend not have depends dependent component, but as a resource. The Fat Squirrels DB is the RDS database. I show you later. Docs, this is the README file that I have in my repository. In my repository, okay, we have Criteo Demo Hot, for example, and in docs index.md, I have my README file. And is the same that I have here. If I change something here, the change I can find the change here. The tab Kubernetes is where can I view all the deploy of in Kubernetes of my application. So I have the RDS instance, the mesh, the deployment ingress service. I can view the summary, but I can view also the YAML file. Prometheus, so like Grafana has the alerts card, but no alerts for now, and a graph where a chart where can I view the container CPU usage for seconds. And the last tab is called Insight, is a insight about my application. So I can view what languages I have used, releases, the compliance reports, and something more. I back to the API of our Fat Squirrels, and I click on Fat Squirrels API. So also the API has the overview tab. We can view that providers and consumers, backend provides this API and frontend consumes it. And we have the definition. We have the open API, the Swagger interface, where can I view endpoint, method, and you can also try and execute the call to view some sample data. I back in the overview, and I go to the Fat Squirrels system. Fat Squirrels system is a group that has all the components of my application. So we have front-end, back-end, APIs, and database. And we have the diagram. So we have with a summary, a graphical view of what there are in my application. We have a domain, a system, API, database, backend, frontend, and obviously I can click, for example, so on the frontend, I can go to the frontend section. The owner is the KiraTech Azure Active Directory. We have the group Kerberos, we have the email and other groups from the Active Directory, the members of this group. And here you can view what service, what OpenAPI has Kerberos. And just for example, you can go so to the user card, and you can go, for example, Lorenzo. Lorenzo is part of the group Kerberos, and this is here is email. Our Fat Squirrels API is just a to-do app. This is the front end. I can write something. I can delete. We have logs. Logs as all the calls as logged, and the logs are saved in a persistent volume with the portworx, and in the portworx dashboard you can view that this is the persistent volume. Currently, I'm using about 2 megabytes of logs. We have Kuma, service mesh. So we have our Fat Squirrels services, the overview, and the YAML file. And okay, I'm back here. Okay, this is the Fat Squirrels front end and back end. But the last thing that you don't need to create an application from zero to Krateo. You can also import an existing application. Just for example, I go to my repository. In the repositories, I have sample OpenAPI Krateo, for example. I have this catalog info YAML. I can get this URL and import this application in our Krateo platform ops. I go back to create, register existing component. I put the URL, analyze, all is okay. I can import and now finish in my dashboard. As you can see, we have the sample OpenAPI Krateo with the about links and all the tabs. And more interesting is that this application is the owner is me directly. So Mauro Sala has the ownership of 5 services and 3 OpenAPI, and Kerberos has 4 services and 3 OpenAPI. These for the user, 5 and 3, is the sum of my services and the services of the group where I'm in. So I think
when I'm coming back to the stage means that your time is finished. No, okay. I'm joking. Thank you so much, Mauro. I have some questions for you. So you showed us Argo CD in a certain point.
Yes.
And I think it's interesting to understand that within the same application of Argo CD, we are describing pods for application, but also the database.
Yes, in the Argo CD dashboard, I'm in the Fat Squirrels application. I'll show you the database is this. So this is the YAML that describes my database on RDS. It's a
okay
YAML.
It's really interesting because what I would like to understand is that you don't need to use different tools. You just need the templates. You just need Argo CD, and then you can describe also mixed components in the same way. So I think that this is really, really great. Okay, Mauro, thank you so much.
Thank you too.
I'll take the stage for the final greetings, and I'll tell you what we are doing with the Krateo Platform Ops in the next steps. So what you saw is 1 year of developing this tool that, as I said, is open source. We invite the community to collaborate with us on Krateo Platform Ops. We do believe that there are a lot of things to do. The next goals that we want to achieve are the Cost Insight plugin for Krateo. So as you can understand, once you standardize any resource, any service within the framework that leverages Kubernetes APIs, then also Cost Insight and cost allocation becomes an easier task, not easy, but easier. And as Mauro showed us right now, once you describe infrastructural application components using the same way, then you can also simplify also the release orchestration part. So you don't need to be cloud native to use release orchestration that is cloud native by itself. So you can apply the same tool for release orchestration to the resources that are on your Kubernetes cluster, but these resources could be also CRs that are logical representation of something that is outside. And once you have all your data centralized, as Yannis showed us, then you can do autoscaling that is not based just on Kubernetes autoscaling, but whatever resource you are able to scale and based on your service level indicators and service level objectives. So thank you so much for participating to the webinar. I hope that it's been really interesting and you had fun as much as we have. And please, if you want to keep in touch with me, you can find me on Twitter, or my account is Braghetos. And we will share the slides so you will keep the contacts. You can write us on our website, that is krateo.io. And I hope to see you next time and have fun. Be safe. Thank you so much.